using AR in-house in order to augment and enhance our experience and our business and application for our users. And the evolution of how we got into AR, what we did in order to get things going. But in order to start, I want to give a brief introduction to who we are with this house. This is the house that actually started Houzz. It's the house of the two founders, Adi and Alon, who started building this house and then discovered that the entire remodeling industry is really set back in the last century. It's very hard to communicate with professionals, to find professionals to do their days. So they decided to change it and started building a website to help communicate and get inspired with ideas. It's not only a website, we've also built a very successful mobile app. And in 2016, we won the inaugural Google Play Award for the best app. And Houzz today is really one-stop shop for everything you want to do about your house. To get inspired, to get ideas, to find a professional to help you materialize and execute on your ideas, and also to shop for items for your house. And since then, we've also expanded internationally. We are today in 14 different markets, and we have offices in different places. We're mostly in charge of receiving and curating global content so it will be relevant to users. So, what are we doing with AR? So one of the things that this is a true comment from one of our discussion forums that came from a user who bought a sofa on our website and experienced buyer's remorse, and when she saw that it actually doesn't look in her room like she thought it would look. And we decided that we wanted to try and fix that and make sure that never happens again when buying through a house. So one of the things that we always try to do is make the shopping experience as good or even better than buying in a physical store. So we said, okay, we want to be able to let the users visualize this in their room, take advantage of the fact that we are running on a mobile device that could be in the user's room. But at that time, we're talking about 2015, we didn't have a big library, we didn't have any library of 3D models, so that was one obstacle in order to get that, enable that experience. So we decided to go on a very simple experience, let's call it 2D over 3D, of basically taking the product images that we have, algorithmically removing the background, so they are over a transparent background, and then overlaying that on top of the camera image. So it's a very simple experience. You might think that it's not very technologically sexy, but it did the job. It had the advantage that the fact that it was a 2D experience made manipulation a lot simpler to the user of the users. Okay, and we started with that experience, and we very quickly saw that it gained a lot of traction. In fact, 50%, half of all the users who bought a product on Houzz viewed the product using this simple AR experience. It's probably that's what we call it AR. that really gave us motivation to continue in developing this experience. So by this time we started, we already had started building a library of 3D models of the products that we have. We already had around 300,000 models. And we were looking at different AR solutions in order to present that. And we were really not very satisfied, very happy with the level of AR experience that was available back in, it was now, like 2015. If you wanted to get accurate scaling, most of the time you had to use markers, and that was something that we felt that our users, which are ordinary household users, will not go and do. It's not something that would make this experience very available. And we ended up opting for a very simple experience where we simply placed the 3D object on the top of the camera scene. There was no tracking whatsoever. It basically tracked the camera. And that was kind of the first AR, more realistic AR experience that we showed it over the 2D image. You had an image that could actually rotate the object and set its rotation in the image. It started showing even more traction. And then about a year after we released this model, Apple came out with AirKit. And the fact that we already had this working helped us convert and adapt to AirKit very quickly, because we already had, we were rendering using Symbian, Apple's rendering framework. So in AirKit, integrates with that seamlessly, so it was very easy. And then you basically had, this is how it looks today. We had a full AR experience, and we relied on the AirKit ability to measure scale to get to place the objects accurately and at scale in the objects. So we could remove the UI that we had previously for scaling our objects. About 6 months later, Google came out with AR Core, and immediately we went, we were available on that too. And it's now the AR experience is totally integrated into our shopping experience. You view a product, you can immediately tap a button to see it in AR in your room. You can go from the AR experience, as you see here, to the shopping cart, and you can see what it is. So it's totally integrated into our experience. And one of the things that we saw that it has a very huge impact on our business. Basically, a product that has a 3D model and has the AR experience available is 11 times more likely to convert, to yield a purchase than a product without it. So that's definitely a very high motivation to continue to invest in AR. And so today, our catalog of 3D models includes over 1 million objects. And in the year since AirKit, in the year plus 2 months since AirKit. In the year plus since
portion of our products and actually some of the more selling products are actually wall-mounted products. And when ARKit came out, it had horizontal plane detection. It didn't have any vertical plane detection. And since we wanted to enable people to also visualize wall-mounted products, we basically came up with a scheme that used the image tracking capabilities of ARKit ARCore and the device sensors. Basically, the experience is you take your device and tell you, put it on the wall wherever you want to hang your product. Now go away and then see the product on the wall as it is. And it sounds a bit more cumbersome, but it actually went well with the, it had a nice metaphor to actually placing the object on the wall. So that made the experience more usable. And when ARKit 1.5 came out with for vertical plane detection, we tested it, and we actually discovered that, well, first of all, it didn't work so well for most of the walls in the house, because walls are white, and so don't have a lot of features. So the feature detection, which ARKit relies on, doesn't work very well. And our experience felt really more easy to use, so we decided to keep on using it. In fact, in spite of the fact that ARKit Pro supports vertical plane detection, as ARKit new versions come out, we will continue to evaluate this and see at one point that it will be correct to switch the ARKit plane detection. How do you think this works better? I brought a video to show you how this experience works, but unfortunately the video doesn't work here in this presentation, so you have just to leave me there. It's pretty nice. In addition, we another thing that we did, another part of our products are actually ceiling mounted products, right? And the horizontal plane detection of ARKit on ceilings wasn't that perfect, and we eventually discovered that what we need to do is basically assume a median ceiling height. And that assumption helped us in receiving more accurate results, and which reminds me that the original experience that we had, which wasn't really AR, one of the things that we did in the scenes basically assumed that typical height user holds his phone at typical height and typical angle, and based on that, we estimated the floor is going to kind of place the product in a good position. That worked quite well, actually. So, what can you learn from our experience that AR is basically a very valuable tool in order to enhance our shopping experience, and the impact that it had for us is making products 11 times more likely to be purchased when they have using AR, and then we also see that 50% of people that buy products on Houzz view that product beforehand
shows how people are starting or becoming very accustomed, very used to viewing products in AR. It's not a novelty technology that users have to have a hard time in learning and explaining how to use it. Users know how to use that and use it, and really enhances the experience. And where do you want to go from here? Well, we feel that we can do a lot more interesting things when we employ different machine learning algorithms to better understand the scene. And one of the things that we feel that it will be used for in the future, I know that we're already working on that, and you saw some discussion about that in earlier lectures today, that it will be used in order to solve occlusions of physical objects, occluding augmented reality objects, which would make the objects seem a lot more in the scene. We are also exploring interesting ways where we can let users collaborate on ideas using AR, and also applications that would be more specific to what we do. For example, letting people actually change the physical scene with the augmented reality. And the main takeaway I would like to take from this is that always think about the technology and what value it brings to your users. Don't try to bring technology because it's cool technology. Try to bring it because it brings value. So for example, the 2D over 3D experience, most AR experts or geeks will tell you, well, it's not very interesting. Technology, it's a very simple technology, yet it had a very profound